The Secret Life of a Vet, written and read by Rory Cowlam. Introduction. I'm Rory. I'm a companion animal vet working at the neighbourhood vet in South London. That essentially means I treat dogs and downwards, as I tell people when I meet them. I have had a passion for animals as long as I can remember, and as a child, I was never without pets. From day one, it seemed I had an affinity with animals. I was born into a house with cats, and they would often be found sitting near or next to me. It wasn't only the cats. As soon as I could crawl, I was out in the garden exploring, collecting insects, fascinated by the natural world. Upon seeing that I was clearly a very young Dr. Doolittle, my parents decided to get a dog when I was just four. They evidently knew I was going to be an animal lover, but not even they realised just to what extent. I was a vet by the age of 22, having studied at one of the best veterinary schools in the world, and was now ready to become a practising city vet. The veterinary profession is an incredible mishmash of high-tech medicine and surgery and the beautiful innocence of caring for animals. And it all started for me at the tender age of four. If you are listening to this book thinking that being a veterinary professional is filled with cuddling cute puppies and kittens and giving a vaccination and a worming tablet, then I implore you to keep going. It's so much more than that. Being a vet is an incredible career. I am privileged to be one and even more honoured to be able to give you a glimpse into it. My aim is to give you a sneak peek into this ever-changing, topsy-turvy life. I want to cover it all, from a childhood fascinated with animals in the heart of the Cotswolds, through the insane world of veterinary school, and into the early years of being a young vet fighting to stay afloat through blood, sweat, and tears. It's all here. And of course, it is all predictably, but ever so rightly, dedicated to the wonderful animals I am privileged enough to spend my life treating and helping in some small way. Chapter 1. In the Beginning. The first animal I shared a special connection with was a cat called Creamy. My mother adopted her before she had me, along with her sister Peaches, from the Cats Protection League. I loved Creamy, and she loved me, sleeping next to me as a newborn baby and tucking herself in my pram while my mum wasn't looking. People used to worry, having heard the horror stories of cats smothering babies in their cots, but I came to no harm, and Creamy and I were inseparable. My parents loved to call her the guard cat because she was always with me with one eye open to make sure I was okay. My mum told me stories as I got older about Creamy and her sister. My favourite was from 1988 in St Albans. Mum must have told me this a million times, and I used to recite it word for word when talking to whoever would listen to me about my love of animals. She told me how Creamy and Peaches were the most amazing cats. Not a paw wrong until very early one morning, she was woken by incessant meowing coming from outside. Now, this was out of character. They were usually very independent cats, so she went downstairs and opened the front door. Creamy was there, on the front step, meowing and scratching at the door, carrying Peaches by the scruff. This amazing little black and white cat must have seen her sister stroll out into the road and take a glancing blow from a speeding car. She had picked her up and dragged her up the steep steps to the front door. Without her, Peaches would not have survived. She was a true feline superhero. By the time I was born, Peaches was no longer around. Creamy and her new adopted sister Topsy were the two animal residents of our home for the first 3 years of my life. When I was 4 years old, however, my mum, my dad, my little sister and I went on a car journey that would change my life forever. We were off to pick up our first dog, Lulu. She was a blue Great Dane, and she very quickly grew from the size of a rugby ball to twice the size of me. She instantly became my best friend and guardian. If you know the story of Peter Pan, you'll be familiar with my favourite character, Nana, of course. The darling family's dog. Lulu became my very own Nana and would regularly look out for me when we were out and about. I used to ride my bicycle into school along with my sister Bethan, my mum and Lulu. we would cycle through the park, and if I rode off too far ahead, Lulu was not far behind. If I ever got out of view of my mum, Lulu would grab onto my handlebars and not let go until my mum had caught up with us. It was bloody annoying, but what a dog. Back home, I quickly decided that wherever Lulu was, I needed to be. I would rush home from school and dive straight onto the floor by her bed, sitting there for hours on end. We played like siblings in the garden and shared a dog biscuit or two. She was my shadow and best friend. We have had many dogs over the years, and I have loved every single one of them. But as I sit in my office writing now, though, there is a picture of Lulu on the bookshelf. We were kindred spirits. I was born in Windsor, but grew up in the Cotswolds, where I spent as much time around animals as possible. Despite being a fully-fledged Londoner now, I still think of the Cotswolds as my spiritual home. With rolling fields filled with cows, sheep, pigs and horses, and windy backroads leading from farmstead to farmstead, bordered by hedges so high that you can only see over them from atop a tractor. From the age of 4 until 7, we lived in Cirencester, in a tall townhouse with a long, thin garden. Lulu and I would run the length of the garden over and over and share an apple from the orchard. It was wonderful, but it wasn't until we moved out of the town to a little village called Hankerton that I felt like a proper country boy. The house sits nestled between three fields, with the nearest neighbour in a cottage at the end of the 200-metre driveway. My favourite part of the house was my forest, a wooded area at the back of the house, with a huge horse chestnut tree at the centre. It was here that I spent a lot of my time with the dogs, collecting conkers, building bonfires, and climbing trees. If I wasn't cuddling or playing with the dogs, after we got Lulu, it sort of opened the floodgates. We had three dogs for the majority of my childhood. I was out in the garden, trying to learn as much as I could about nature. We had chickens and ducks, and geese for a time, and living, surrounded by farmland, I was always off exploring. I was lucky to have parents who made sure to teach me as much about animals as possible, including involving me in raising and rearing animals for food production. And it wasn't uncommon for me to be helping my dad in the garden, growing enough vegetables to feed the village, or helping my mum in the kitchen, where she passed on her love of cooking to me. Otherwise, in between tormenting my little sister and playing with her in the garden, I was off finding insects or wildlife to learn about. Our chickens and ducks provided the most amazing eggs, and it was my job to collect them in the morning before school, as well as to fill up their food and water. At one point, we had over a dozen hens, and we had eggs coming out of our ears. I managed to persuade my mum that if I could sell the eggs and deliver them, I could keep the cash as pocket money. So off I went around the village on my bike, boxes of eggs stacked in a carrier bag swinging from my handlebars. At weekends, I would help clean the chickens' enclosure out and bed them on clean straw. Ordinarily, this was an easy job, but then there was the cockerel. We had a number of cockerels over the years, and I thought they were wonderful, providing fertilised eggs for us to hatch into cute little chicks. Although a bit feisty, they were manageable. Then, for a few years, there was Rocky Delboy III. Bethan and I used to fight over naming the various animals we had, which meant that we would frequently end up with some unconventional names. When naming our very first cockerel, we both took inspiration from our favourite films and TV shows. I loved any film about animals, of course. To this day, my favourite film is Lion King. And if you went to see the new live-action version in the cinema recently, yep, I was the adult man crying his eyes out when Mufasa died. My film of choice at the time was Chicken Run, in which the rooster, bloody Americans, was called Rocky. My sister, on the other hand, was a big fan of Only Fools and Horses, thanks to our dad's influence, meaning that when our mum asked what she wanted to call the new cockerel, Delboy was of course her choice. Rocky Delboy was christened, and then a few years down the line, Rocky Delboy III arrived. Rocky Delboy II, incidentally, after we'd asked a local farmer to source us a cockerel, turned out to be a bantam. For those of you that don't know, bantams are like the hobbits of the chicken world. And, try as he might to have his way with our flock of full-sized, plump, Rhode Island red hens, come spring, there were no little chicks. Safe to say, he was quickly replaced by RDB III, who was a white Sussex cockerel, about 6 months old, and, unlike his predecessor, absolutely gigantic. Now, I like to think I was born with an affinity for animals, but RDB III really didn't want to be my friend. Every morning, bleary-eyed in the dark and cold, I would head out to the chicken enclosure with a pot of food and the hose to fill their water. I would get to the gate, and no matter how quiet I was, he would be there, waiting, his red eyes staring up at me. And as I approached, he would puff himself up, and I swear he used to grow a full foot taller. I very quickly learnt that I needed some sort of defence when dealing with RDB III, and I found myself a large wooden board. I felt like a Roman soldier, holding my shield out in front of me, parrying away his vicious attacks. As soon as my hand went on the door of the coop, he would start a low growl, and then, as the door opened, his aggression would escalate to full-flung attacks, talons out, wings flapping, battering away at my pathetic wooden defence system. I must have spent hours being chased around the coop by that bloody cockerel, fearing that he would scar me for life with his sharp beak. I must admit, I wasn't that upset when I came out one morning to find that the only bit left of RDB III was his head, lying in the corner of the enclosure where the wire had been expertly lifted by a cunning fox. My mum was the driving force behind my obsession with animals. She had always wanted to be a vet, but never pursued her dream, and she quickly decided that it would be the perfect path for me. Everyone thinks their mother is the best, but I'm afraid you're all wrong. Mine wins. She was, and still is, hugely supportive and encouraging of everything I wanted to do without ever pushing me to do anything. When I decided I wanted to work with animals, she helped me contact local farms, rescue centres and stables so that I could get hands-on experience with a huge range of animals. If I wanted to do something animal-related, she would do everything in her power to make it happen. She is a proper superhero. I count myself incredibly lucky to have grown up in the countryside since it afforded me so many opportunities, which I would not have had in the city. From the age of 10, I worked on a local farm, helping at lambing time and, more often than not, making dens in the straw bales. I had a school friend, weirdly also named Rory, who was a farmer's son. One of my happiest childhood memories is the two of us setting up those green plastic army men you used to be able to get along one of the wooden beams of the big straw barn, and then shooting them down with BB guns or air rifles. I could also drive farm machinery from a very young age and learnt to reverse a trailer at 13, taught by my dad. I tell you what, it's not as easy as it looks. When I turned 15, I started volunteering at an amazing wildlife rescue centre called Oak and Furrows. It was run by the most incredible woman, Serena. She had started the centre in memory of her late daughter, and her passion for the place was fierce and unwavering. The centre itself was hidden in woodland near the lakes of South Cerny, a little haven of wildlife tucked away from the busy A419, and a mere half an hour's cycle ride away from my house. I loved the place as soon as I set foot on the site. I could be found helping with injured hedgehogs, pigeons, foxes, badgers, and all sorts of other British wildlife, to which I quickly became hugely devoted. Lambing was always a fun time of the year, and I can't have been much more than 11 or 12 years old, sitting on the sofa watching some television before bed, when the landline rang. My mother answered, and with a tone of surprise, shouted to me to come to the phone. The mystery caller turned out to be the local farmer. He had a lambing ewe and needed my help. I was so flattered that I jumped straight on my bike and raced up to the farm. I had been helping him out for the previous few months, getting the barn set up for lambing, and then helping feed and look after the lambs once they started arriving. The scene that greeted me that evening was of the mother-to-be sheep lying on her side in the floodlit barn. I had seen this done a number of times before, and I wasn't afraid to get stuck in. I do wonder how many 11-year-olds would be happy jumping straight in to help with a lambing on a farm, but I didn't think twice and quickly dropped to her side. I remember it as clear as day. One hoof was sticking out of the sheep's vulva with what looked like a little black nose next to it. The sheep had been struggling for about 30 minutes and the farmer had been trying to help. The farmer was a nice, kind fella. He had always been very encouraging of my love of animals and welcomed my help whenever I was available, especially as he was getting on a bit. Whenever I picture a farmer, I see a rugged, thick-set, six-foot-something chap with rough spades for hands. Mr. Douglas, as I knew him, was almost exactly the opposite. He was slight in build, but strong as an ox, with piercing dark eyes behind ornate, tortoiseshell varifocals. He was a gentleman farmer. I'm sure through the years he had delivered thousands of lambs in a matter of moments, but these days it was a bit tricky for him. Farming is a tough job at the best of times, let alone during lambing season. Having spent a lot of time on farms already, I had watched vets and farmers help deliver lambs and calves. Now, for the first time, it was my turn. I grabbed a bottle of lubricant, industrial-sized bottles are commonplace on farms, and slid my hand up the side of the exposed hoof. The lamb's head was wedged against its front leg, its tongue sticking out about a centimetre from its lips. As I surveyed the situation, I began to worry that I was dealing with a dead lamb. But just as that thought crossed my mind, almost as if it could hear me, the lamb gave a little flick of its tongue. It was subtle and weak, but it was an unmistakable sign of life. I sped up. The head and one leg were pointing forwards, but its other leg had been left behind, wedging the lamb in the mother's birthing canal. I had seen Mr. Douglas and his sons deliver enough of these by now to know that this wasn't right. Lambs were meant to be born with their two legs angled forwards, alongside their head. I told Mr. Douglas what I could feel, and he explained that my only option was to lubricate around the head and push the lamb back in, to try to reposition it back in the mother's uterus. I quickly did just that and had the lamb back in the uterus in a matter of seconds. The farmer watched on. "You made that look easy, lad," he said, as a word of encouragement. "I think the mum is tired. She isn't pushing much," I replied. Usually, when you're trying to move an unborn lamb, or any fetus for that matter, around inside its mother, you fight a constant battle against the mother's strong pushes and contractions, trying to get you and their young out as quickly as possible. I was now lying on the floor, perpendicular to the mother, up to my elbow, trying to reposition the lamb. I felt around and grabbed onto the second front leg, then gently pulled it into the mother's pelvis to align the lamb. I think the sheep could sense that I had done what was needed, because as soon as I had the lamb aligned, she gave an almighty push, which expelled both my right arm and her lamb out into the big wide world. The lamb flopped on the floor and lay motionless. I just sat up and watched, not knowing what to do. Thankfully, Mr. Douglas stepped in. He must have dealt with this sort of thing hundreds of times. In a flash, he scooped the lamb up in one hand, using his other hand to poke a finger into the back of its throat to clear away all the goo that comes with birth. Then, he started gently swinging the lamb backwards and forwards. He did this for about 10 seconds, then laid it down and rubbed its body vigorously with straw. This process was one that I would come to use hundreds of times over the next 15 years, and one that is cemented in my brain from that very evening. The farmer and I crouched there, holding our breath, watching the lamb for any signs of life. The farmer was so calm. I, on the other hand, sat there anxiously looking at the lamb, then to the farmer, and then back to the lamb, like I was watching an odd game of tennis. The lamb coughed into life, and it started to shake its head. It was alive. I released my breath. I think I'd been holding it for about a minute and a half. Mr. D gently placed the lamb by its mother's head, and, despite her exhaustion, she lifted her head and started to lick at her new lamb. It was a magical sight, and I lay back onto the straw and closed my eyes. I wanted to remember that moment forever. This was the first life I had ever helped deliver, and it was the best feeling ever. I sat back up and said goodbye to the farmer, jumped onto my bike and pedalled home. As I walked through the door, I called out to my mum, excited to tell her the tale of my evening, and was just starting to ramble when she said, "Right, hold that thought, strip, and you can take that sheep shit from behind your ear as well. Country living, eh?" As a schoolboy, you're meant to make friends for life. Well, someone forgot to give me that memo. I'm not sure if it was because I felt I understood animals better than humans, but I found making friends a challenge. Don't get me wrong, I tried, but I always felt more at home hanging out with four-legged species rather than two. I often wondered whether I would have been better suited to one of those posh boarding schools with a farm on site, but then I would have had to be away from my family, which would have been out of the question. As well as animals, I loved two other things, cooking and sport. Cooking came from my mother, sport from my father. My dad had been a semi-professional footballer and school county champion at hurdling back in the day. He would have loved to work in sport, yet ended up as a London businessman. I'm sure he enjoyed his job, but he always preached to me to do something I loved. He got me playing football from a very early age, and I ended up playing for a few teams through my schoolboy days. Sadly, I hadn't inherited my dad's natural talent, but God loves a trier. My dad and I would sit down every Sunday and watch Formula One, and as many football games as we could. And when I decided I had had enough of football and preferred rugby, he started taking me to games at Bath and Gloucester. I found school tricky, at least the social side, but I made do, working with a clear vision of where I wanted to be 10 years down the line. I was never happier than at the wildlife centre, riding stables, or on the farm, and that is where I spent most of my free time. When at school, I used any opportunity to learn more about veterinary and the animal world, focusing my work experience placements and school reports around my future profession. Being from the Cotswolds, when I finally got to start visiting veterinary surgeries to gain experience, I chose to spend a lot of my time in surgeries dotted around the countryside. The James Herriot style of veterinary, seeing from puppies to shire horses and everything in between, this is what I grew up fantasising about. But unfortunately, the romanticised tales of veterinary practice in beautiful British countryside, like the rolling Yorkshire Dales, with incredible stories of the most unusual characters, are a bit of a dying dream. The closest I ever got to this was driving around the Cotswolds, jumping from farm to farm, and I loved every minute of it. The Herriot books had always been a huge inspiration for me as a young boy, and I have never felt, and probably never will feel, more connected to him than I did in those days. My parents had made sure to introduce me to the novels of Alf White, James Herriot was his pen name, as soon as I started to read. I think I must have read them all from cover to cover at least a dozen times, each time driving me further onto the veterinary path. He was soon my biggest idol, and a huge force behind my love for animals and veterinary. When I was 12 or 13, I went up to Thirsk, near York, to visit the Herriot Museum and got lost amongst the historic equipment, photographs and incredible stories from the 20th century. If you haven't seen it before, I cannot recommend strongly enough that you watch an episode of All Creatures Great and Small, the television adaptation of Herriot's stories. It is simply wonderful. Over the years, as I said, this style of veterinary practice has passed me by, and city veterinary is what I've settled upon. It isn't what I had always dreamed of, but I have found my passion for it has developed and grown alongside me and my skills as a vet. I spend the majority of my time seeing cats and small breed dogs, and I absolutely miss animals bigger than a spaniel, but for now, I love what I do. As much as I love to think back to mixed animal practice with fondness, I can't help but be brought back to reality with a bump. Times are changing massively in the veterinary world. It is the era of corporate veterinary, and vets are increasingly made to choose between pets, farm, and equine work. As advancement after advancement is made in the medical field, both human and veterinary, the limitations of what we can do for animals are being reduced. We can do things in veterinary medicine nowadays that Alf White and his colleagues could only have dreamed of. With this, not only comes more knowledge and skills for the modern-day vet to learn, but also a heightened expectation from clients that the vet should know everything about everything to do with their animal. With that overload of knowledge, it is simply not possible to provide the high level of service expected from farmers, horse owners, and pet owners if you are spreading yourself across all disciplines. As time goes on, the gap between the care we give our pets and the care we provide humans is closing. I love nothing more than comparing notes with doctors on what treatments and latest technology they're using in human medicine and surgery. Inevitably, they always leave that conversation impressed with the level of care we give our patients. While at university, I had to make the decision as to whether to treat pets or farm animals. I love horses, don't get me wrong, but I could never see myself treating them. I ultimately came back to the animals I loved the most. It all started for me with my pet, dogs and cats, so they are what I decided to dedicate my veterinary career and life to. Chapter 2. A Young Dr. Doolittle. I wanted to be a vet from the age of 4. My mum had been pestering my dad for years to get a dog. He wasn't the biggest animal man back then. You should see him now, though. He had never had a dog, and he was definitely not like me with my love for all things great and small. I must admit, I don't remember the exact way it happened, but eventually he gave in, and one of my strongest memories from my childhood is sitting in the car on the way to pick up our new puppy. My mum had always wanted a Great Dane. It had all begun long before she ended up with my father, with a Great Dane called Heidi. She was the first Great Dane my mum ever met, and belonged to a guy she had been dating. They lived in Cockfosters, and my mum would go and meet her boyfriend in the pub. They would sit and have a few drinks, with Heidi curled up under the table. My mum would often head home before the rest of the guys. She always has been a bit of a lightweight. The walk home was through a park, frequented by slightly dodgier members of society after dark. So, Heidi would take my mother's hand gently in her mouth and walk her through the park like her personal bodyguard. Once home safe, Heidi would turn around and head back to the pub to join the rest of the gang. My mum, understandably, had felt completely safe and fallen head over heels with Heidi, less so her owner. Her obsession with Great Danes began, and 20-something years later, that's exactly what we were getting. Looking back now, it was quite a commitment. If someone came to me with no experience of dogs and said they were going to get a Great Dane, I would probably tell them they were mad. We were on the way to the breeder's house. We had picked the puppy out weeks ago, and it was finally the day to go and collect her. I couldn't contain my excitement, and we spent almost the entire journey discussing where she was going to sleep, how we were going to settle her in, and, most importantly of all, her name. As you'll remember from the incredibly named cockerel, Rocky Delboy III, we each got a vote. My sister was only 2 or 3 at the time, and she put up a huge fight for Miss Muffet. These days, I see upwards of 20 pets a day in my job, and I have come across some pretty amazing names. But the thought of my mother, or even better, my father, in the field next to our house shouting, "Jesus Christ, Miss Muffet! Just bloody come back!" starts me in fits of laughter. I like to think I got my choice because my suggestion was so far superior, but I'm sure it was simply due to the fact that my parents didn't want to name the dog after a character from a nursery rhyme. I had sat thinking in the back of the car for most of the journey and finally suggested Lulu. To this day, I have no idea where it came from. I must have been a huge fan of 1960s pop when I was 4. Lulu it was, and it was absolutely perfect. We picked up Lulu at the tender age of 8 weeks and had her until she was 10 years old. That's quite a long life for a Dane, and something I've always been quite proud of. When we picked her up, she was all limbs, feet bigger than my 4-year-old hands, with ears that drooped almost to the floor. She was everything I had ever dreamed of, and I fell in love with her at first sight. She was a deep, rich blue-grey colour, known as blue officially, something that I found hilarious as a kid. My friends used to ask what colour my dog was, and I took great pride in announcing that she was blue, usually to my peers' disbelief. After all, who had ever seen a blue dog? Once we got her back home to the Cotswolds, like any new puppy owners, one of the most important things my parents had to do was take her to the vets to get her checked over and start her vaccinations. I wanted to be involved in every small part of dog ownership, of course, so I announced that I had to be there for the first visit. I had never been to the vets before, but my mum already knew I had a love for animals that was special. There was a veterinary surgery at the end of the street where my grandmother lived. Every time we went to visit her, I would ogle the masses of animals heading in and out of the clinic. That weekend, we arrived at the veterinary surgery car park and got out with our little blue bundle of joy. My mum carried her from the car to the surgery. I was definitely not strong enough to carry her. Yes, she was a puppy, but at 8 weeks, she was already pushing the scales at a meaty 10 kilograms. Far too much for me. We found our way into the waiting room and took a seat among the bustling menagerie of dogs and cats. I could hardly contain myself with so many animals to say hello to, but I stayed put and dutifully cuddled our little pup. She was by far the cutest in the waiting room. "Lulu Cowlam," came the shout from the vet's room. He had a northern twang which softened his bellowing voice. This is something that never fails to amuse people whenever I'm chatting about my job with friends. They always chuckle that I have to come and call the pet's name in the waiting room. There are some eccentrically incredible pet names out there. Captain Thunderpants, the puppy who used to wake himself up when he passed wind. Mr. Meowgy, the cat that used to get a new fighting wound every week. Tinkerbell, the Rottweiler, one of my favourites. And of course, Dave the cat. Because who doesn't love a cat called Dave? We entered the room with Lulu, and I got my first glimpse of a veterinary consulting room. It was a large, whitewashed room with high ceilings and laminate floors. Very clinical, as you might expect. There was a single picture on the wall, with a clock hanging above it. The picture was of a countryside scene and hasn't moved from that wall to this day. The centrepiece of the room was a large metal block table with a black rubber matting on the top. It was about as tall as me at the time. My mum walked in and popped Lulu down on the table as I stood in the corner and looked up at the vet. He had a huge presence in that room, and I remember thinking I hadn't ever met anyone so in charge of everything. He held a hand out to my mother. "Rod Benson," he introduced himself. He had thick, dark hair, bright eyes, and the tan of someone not shy to the outdoors. He had to be in his 30s at the time and was in great shape. The beauty of a physical job. He wore a checked, short-sleeved shirt and beige corduroy trousers with a white medical coat over the top. We were in that consulting room for almost an hour, the first of many visits to come, and the conversation did not let up. Please don't be fooled. We spent about 15 minutes discussing Lulu, and the rest was filled with topics such as growing up in Yorkshire as a child, which, as it turned out, my mother and Mr. Benson had in common. Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, which was, and still is, one of Mr. Benson's favourite films. Marathon running, one of Mr. Benson's casual pastimes. And finally, the intricacies of classic cars, another passion of his. It was an awesome experience, though, and I sat listening in awe for the whole consult. Mr. Benson got me involved. He let me listen to Lulu's heart through a stethoscope, and he even showed me how to use the weighing scales to see how much Lulu weighed, and then how much I weighed. It was amazing. We said our goodbyes and left the vets, Lulu having slept through her first puppy vaccination. My mum paid at the front desk, and we ambled out onto the street towards the car. Now, this is the part of the story I don't remember, but my mother swears by it. As we left the vets and the door swung shut, I looked up at my darling mother with my big blue eyes. Yes, I told you it was my mother's story. And said, "Mummy, when I grow up, I want to be a vet just like Mr. Benson." And the rest, as they say, is history. After that initial meeting, I saw Mr. Benson pretty regularly. At the time, we had two cats, Creamy and Topsy, as well as Lulu. So we were regulars at the vets, and I was not one to pass up a visit to see my future mentor. I was the kid that made my mother make appointments after picking me up from school so I could go along. I loved the vets. Soon, we were familiar enough with Mr. Benson to have a conversation about me spending some time in clinic with him and his team to see what the world of vetting was like from the other side of the consulting table. We had regularly discussed the fact that I had decided I wanted to be a vet, and Mr. Benson was always encouraging and enthusiastic about my future career. When we broached the subject of work experience, Mr. Benson made a point of telling my mother that he had recently stopped taking school students as they never got involved enough, and just stood in a corner and didn't make themselves useful. But my mother and I assured him that I would throw myself in head first and ask all the right questions. He agreed, and I booked in a week to spend with him in the school holidays. I was just turning 14, and by that point I had known I wanted to be a vet for almost 10 years. It's a weird one, veterinary. It gets under your skin. For me, there was never anything else, and it was such an early goal, I had always just assumed that's how it was for everyone. I still remember when I was a young lad that friends, parents, teachers and any manner of interested adults would always ask the standard question, "So, what do you want to be when you grow up?" "I'm going to be a vet," was always my answer, and it was met with a mixture of reactions, but always with a look to my parents, almost as if to say, "Well, he's damn sure of himself, huh?" I must have been a few years into veterinary school when I was home for one of our infrequent university breaks. I was wandering around Cirencester, a town I had called home for a large portion of my life, and near where my parents still live. I was with my oldest friend from primary school, James, and we were just getting a coffee and having a catch-up. We had always been close. I couldn't tell you how many hours we whiled away playing football in the park or collecting the latest craze like Pokemon cards or Warhammer. James was now at Cardiff University, reading business and economics. He was a bit of a business whiz, and the course suited him. We were walking up from Starbucks, and I caught a glimpse of someone I thought I recognised heading into Jessop's. I told James to hurry up, and we ran up to the window and gawked through. I was right. It was Mrs. P. She had been our Year 4 primary school teacher, but had also taught us English. I had always been a slightly hyper child and never stayed seated in class, but Mrs. P found the right balance between respect and sheer fear, so I was generally a bit better behaved in her class. She had always taken a bit of extra time with me, and I had never really known why until she suggested to my parents that I was struggling slightly with English. She had her suspicions and wondered whether I could be dyslexic. At that time, there wasn't much help for dyslexic children, but she was the first teacher to take enough interest to notice, and years later at university, I was indeed diagnosed with dyslexia. She always had a big curly perm and a kind face with a sharp nose. She regularly wore a dress with a blazer, and that is exactly how she was on that day in Jessop's. Our primary school had since closed down, so I never had the option of going back to visit the place. I hadn't seen Mrs. P since leaving primary school, and I just had to say hello. We waited until she had finished at the counter, and, as she turned around, I said, "I'm really sorry to interrupt, but you're Mrs. P, aren't you?" "Well, well, well, Rory Cowlam, how are you?" she said with some disbelief. Looking me up.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.